next speaker is Maxim Sobolev. Probably you know him because he has a very long experience, starting from, let me remember, I think 2004, or what was it?
When, 2003, 2004.
Yeah, so that was one of the first solutions for the media playing in the old times of...
Well, we started with NotHelper, and then kind of go from there.
And today he will talk about SIP in the age of IoT.
Well, I need to correct you. We made some late minute change to the topic of the talk, so now it's called IoT in the age of SIP. And it might be important that other stuff next time. Okay, so first of all, let me thank the organizers, everybody, Bogdan, Alex, everybody involved, QX team, everybody involved in organizing this event, and also letting us to speak out here. So we've been, it's been a third summit for us, and nothing but great time. So who we are? We have two kind of hands to us. So we have Sippy Software, which is our commercial entity, and we've been in business since 2006, and we basically package a bunch of software. Some of the names you probably know already. Some of them not, but anyway, and provide a complete solution to small and medium-sized IDSP carriers, essentially. And then we have our open source arm, which is called Sippy Labs. We have a few projects of our own, like SP Proxy, B2BA, and SIP Stack, new B2BA, B-Cluster. We also do some integration tests for between OpenSIPS and and other components. Being as Bogdan said, being around for such a long time, we learned one thing that we learned about this whole process is that ideas are perhaps more important than particular implementation. And that's kind of when people ask us what we think about R2P engine versus R2P proxy, basically just so. Original idea got implemented in different ways, and people put time and effort to make it better, so great. Now, going back to the topic of this talk, so what we're going to talk about? This kind of picture gives a little bit of idea what we have in mind. We're going to talk about our vision of the future. Essentially, there are two ways to talk about the future. You can talk about the future as a prophecy, or you can make a forecast. And the difference, we believe, is that prophecy, just if it does not work, it's bad prophecy. On the other hand, forecast is might be useful still, even if it doesn't realize fully and in parts. Now, before we delve any further into technical matters, let me tell you the story here. Oh, sorry. Yeah, story comes later. So, looking around our vision of the future, look around at the stuff that's going on around us, we see things getting smarter on ever-increasing scale. We already have smart homes, businesses, pretty smart cars, roads, factories. Now they're talking about remote, smart cities, and we believe this trend might go forward. We'll have like smart countries, whatever. In practical sense, what does it mean for all of us? It basically means in our what we think is we'll have sensors everywhere, literally billions, hundreds of billions of them. And they will be collecting the data, real-world data, real-time data, and feed it back to the system for storage and processing correlation and all that. Now before we delve into further into technical matters, a little story. So there is these two young gentlemen on the left side. They are a duo from USA, and the name of the one is Lyle and Jay, and the other one is Shane the Dope. And they are artists, they write songs, and they call them the same clone posse. Once upon a time they write a song, wrote a song which called The Magic, and one of their teams in that song was freaking maggots, how do they work? And they kind of insulted scientists a little bit about that. And so that stuff picked up by this gentleman on the right side, who is his name is Sean Carroll. He is a professor at Caltech, author of many books about cosmology, Higgs boson, and stuff like that. So if you have not heard the song or seen any of the those mentioned talks and books, highly recommended. But basically he started polemizing with them, saying that in his presentation, saying that science knows how magnets work, more or less. In the same team, essentially if you give a sensor to person, regular person, and ask how does it work, say that's magic. Basically, yeah, but I think we know better. So there is essentially sensors 101. So the sensors consist basically of three parts these days. So there is a physics package which interacts with the world outside, reads the data, converts it into electrical signal, fits into some kind of amplifier and signal conditioning, and then resulting signal is fed into either microcontroller or MCU, where it's converted to the digital form, processed a little bit, and then shipped to some centralized location for processing. Essentially, what we think is there is a little bit of kind of void on this end, on the end of the communication protocol, and we think the SIP might be a pretty good fit for that. So, a little bit of SIP 101, you probably guys all know this, but SIP provides scalable endpoint registration, point location, RTP session setup, parameter negotiations, updates, and so on and so forth. Looking at the current what people choose for the role of communication protocol, I think in many cases HTTP is picked up, and we think that it's not the best protocol for the task. Essentially, there are several reasons for that. So HTTP does not support datagram-based communication. Although there is some work at Google, I think, going on to add this. Then the HTTP is strictly client server, so you have completely different implementations on the client and on the server. In SIP, essentially, if you got a SIP stack, you can build either the client or server up to you, or both. And then HTTP does not support persistent sessions as it is, and persistence is added on top, and so it varies across different implementations and such. Obviously, there is no registration location on HTTP, I think the only real reason why HTTP is used is because it's very easy to implement something on top of HTTP. There are a lot of implementations of different sizes and different targets, like from microcontrollers to FPGAs and stuff. But then after you implemented something initially, how do you scale it? Because as I said, we're talking about potentially many millions in points talking to the same server. So obviously you will be having problems with that. Well, on the SIP side, we heard talks today already where people are working on clustering, which would bring make it possible to run millions or tens of millions connected to the same system. So we set a little bit of quest to make a little bit of proof of concept out of this, focusing basically on the software side. So we're trying to implement minimal kind of stack on the sensor side, which would essentially do the task. And then we hook it up to our own production software, which includes OpenSIPS, B2BA, and other stuff. So we don't modify C-band in any way. Then we use just off-the-shelf IoT device to implement the thing, and we try to reuse our existing code whenever it makes sense, and minimize number of dependencies, because we're talking about pretty small systems, and having something like, if you look at the OpenSIPS, it has, if you build a lot of modules, you end up using a lot of external dependencies. And obviously we are not concerned about performance at this point, just to get something working. So there is our little hardware setup. So what we did, we basically looked around our lab and see what we can use as a sensor. And that's a big, big scary gray box here. Essentially, what it is, it's a device which measures current, and you basically connect your battery or power supply on the back, set some parameters on the front, and then press the button, and it measures current as a function of voltage or as well. And outputs it on the serial port. So it's basically a sensor in this way. And then we put on top here is our MCU. We just used off-the-shelf BeagleBone Green, which is ARM Cortex A8 1 GHz. Not the kind of probably not the choice for a very small sensor, but still pretty reasonable these days. And as I said, our goal was of this proof of concept was to make a software. So we basically created a little bit of sensor specific code which reads the data out. We created a little UAC which collects this data and also collects events when you start measuring. And then it's all hooked up to the CPSIP stack. Which is Python SIP stack. We created a little bit of RTP stack as well to help us. And on the bottom, there is L-periodic, which is C library to provide constant rate event scheduling, and another little library which helps to generate RTP state, because Python is not very efficient at it, dependent and stuff. So on the high level, the software looks like we have SIP stack, an event loop in one thread, then we have RTP generation thread, and then sensor IO thread, which reads the data. And all this talks to a bunch of network IO threads, which actually do packets sending and receiving. Essentially, overall, we got the system working. Press the button to start measuring. It basically established SIP session, established RTP session to the receiver. We also created a little receiver application. It's not shown, but it's not important really. And so on that ARM system, it's getting pretty reasonable performance. We don't do any much optimization so far. And most we basically have 10% of CPU active, or less than 1% when it's just in the background. Memory usage is also pretty low. 500 lines of new code. So all the code is on the GitHub, so it can be used. Now we also did a little bit of measurement of result in RTP stream quality. Since a lot of code is a Python, so it was a little concern for us, but it seems doing pretty good job. This graph shows jitters function of time, just our standard Wireshark plot. As you can see, it's pretty straight line, so pretty okay. Could be also improved by just using some, without changing much of the code, but just making the RTP generation code more give it more priority, essentially, and possibly adding some more C code in the layers. The main conclusion that we believe that SIP and RTP combined might have quite interesting new use application outside of its current main use, which is to transport voice. Who knows, could potentially outshadow its current use in just a handful of years. It's just some early ideas, but obviously in order for this to kind of have a bigger application, more standards are necessary, so you can hook up equipment from different vendors into the single system and have it to talk each other, essentially. Should not be too difficult because most of the stuff that those sensors output are just numbers, essentially periodic, like every second it reads something, temperature, pressure, whatever, and generates number which corresponds to that parameter. Obviously, it would be interesting to see some real world deployments somewhere. Raising awareness of about SIP and its potential uses within communities that that promote and develop those smart things. We need some small-scale SIP RTP implementations, which would be optimized for memory, CPU consumption, and CPU size. Maybe PJ SIP, maybe candidate for this, but I don't know if any microcontroller class SIP and RTP implementation, for example. FPGAs. So a little bit of acknowledgements and credits. This work has been partially funded by the scientific research and experimental development tax incentive program of the Government of Canada. Ole Johansson, many of you probably know him. Bounced some of those early ideas during CPIT 016. Obviously, CP software stuff helped me a lot with the presentation, and there are some links for you guys to explore if you're curious about this on the debate that's going on. I think that's more or less it.
I saw that you gave the statistics about the jitter and possible landing of RTP. But why this is relevant if you are just streaming a series of data?
Well, it's real-time data, right? So we are concerned about that. And then on the receiver end, you obviously would need to implement some kind of jitter and reordering buffer. So if your jitter will get too big, you will either have to increase this buffer or start dropping some packets. So it's still relevant because you want consistent stream of data.
Yeah. Did you use some specific codec type, RTP codec type, or you just create your own?
Oh, we actually 7.11 as a codec type because it allows us to use it to test it with the phone. So I basically send my data to Cisco phone, and I can actually hear it.
And are you aware of any standardizations in this area for new codec types for these IoT things?
We have not done a lot of research. There are some, I think there are some industrial standards for encoding this kind of data. But as I said, we're C people, so for us it's a little bit uncharted territory.
Maybe less for me. Did you use like the long-term SIP sessions for it?
Yes, yes.
So how did you get any experience? Like, did you use for hours, days, weeks, sessions?
Well, in our software, we have some of the talks that we've heard yesterday talk about those long sessions. So in our software, we have a hard limit for 2 hours, how long session can last. So it essentially cuts the call after 2 hours. But this little IoT UAC here, it actually redials. So whenever a call is dropped, it basically just keeps buffering data, then redials, and when it's picked up, it basically pushes it out. So essentially, it's not a problem even if calls get dropped at some point. It will basically just resume. Yeah, and there are some contacts and links. And by the way, if using this time, we're doing live streaming and recording on YouTube. So if you miss any of the links or any talks that you might be interested in, you can check it later.
Thank you, Maxim.
Thank you.
David, additional questions?